Gulfstream waters, this land was made for you and me.
Welcome back, everybody, to the People Speak radio show. I'm your host for tonight, Steve Johnson. The People Speak show normally airs every Tuesday from 6 to 7 Pacific and 9 p.m. to 10 p.m. Eastern on the BBS radio network. You can participate during the show with call-in questions for our guests, toll-free in the United States and Canada on 1-888-429-5471. This is a fantastic show tonight. We're talking to two very special guests right here, an anti-nuclear activist and an outspoken advocate of human rights. We are talking tonight to Sister Megan Rice, 85, a Roman Catholic nun of the Society of the Holy Child Jesus, and a fellow activist, Mr. Michael Walli, who is also part of a group that broke into a nuclear facility and spent time in prison. We are very honored to have them with us on the show today. Welcome to the People Speak radio show, Sister Rice and Mr. Walli.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Wonderful to have you here. Can you, first of all, Sister Rice, can you please describe to our listeners the course of events that actually got you incarcerated into a facility because of your activism?
Well, we were very concerned when we realized that the United States government had appropriated probably up to $10 billion, certainly $6 billion in the one facility at Oak Ridge, Tennessee, where the first fuel for the first three highly enriched fuel, uranium fuel, was produced back in 1943 and has been continued to being produced for to fuel the nuclear weapons that have continued to be made since World War II. When they were used in August of 1945. Now, and we needed to remind the people, remind the workers, that this was all illegal work according to the United States Constitution, which holds the United States accountable to all international laws and treaties, which it signs, and supersedes any activity that the United States intends to do. So the construction and the production and certainly the use of ever again nuclear bombs has been since at least 1970, when the Non-Proliferation Treaty was signed, illegal criminal activity. So we wanted to go in to explain that to the workers and to try to end and call them to transform that work into that which is sustainable and life-enhancing, which is very possible to be done.
Wow. So your protest basically was inspired because you believe that what these workers are doing is contributing to a criminal activity that is state-sponsored and state-organized.
Exactly.
Goodness me. Mr. Michael Walli, in your opinion, nuclear weapons, are they part of the pursuit of life, liberty, and peace and happiness for all mankind?
No, they are of the spirit of anti-grace. They are illegal. They are state terroristic in their nature, and they must be eradicated.
And what is the threat that nuclear weapons poses to us as a people on this earth?
It threatened all human life with extinction. It threatens all of the people. Falsely, it is said in various nations that nuclear weapons are providing security, and their stockpiling, use, refurbishment, perpetuation is said to be serving the national defense needs of various nations. This is out and out untruth. They are violations of the security rights. We all have a right to security of person. We cannot accept the situation in which criminal weapons are being used in the false concept that they are providing defense for anybody in the room.
Well, they posed the whole nuclear thing. They invited it into our society as being part of to help us get cheap energy and clean fuel. But that hasn't been the case. Energy prices have gone up. We've seen these things that they're using, the uranium and the plutonium, being used for nefarious purposes, for not only defense, but for offensive weapons. Now, Mr. Michael Walli and Sister Megan, in your opinion, do we need nuclear weapons at all?
Of course, there's no need for nuclear weapons. as Michael has said, they're mutually assured destruction, and that's the only thing that could ever happen. Obviously, there would be retaliation if one ever were used, but it would be against all laws of humanity, the laws of war, and the non-proliferation treaty laws, and many others, even to consider planning and constructing nuclear bombs. So certainly they're of no use. We don't want to destroy our planet.
The existence of them, the proliferation of them, the modernization of them, and the talk about perpetuating their existence by the U.S. government at Oak Ridge and Los Alamos and various vessels on the high seas and ports and nuclear weapon submarines, that's a clear indication that the rule of international law has been thrown out the window long ago, and that various nations of the world allied to the United States have every intention of continuing its faulting efforts to dictate human affairs.
Now, first of all, what got you started? What got you inspired to follow the group into this anti-nuclear activism, Mr. Michael Walli, first of all?
I was encouraged to join by Sister Megan Rice. She was the one who selected the Oak Ridge Y-12 U.S. government nuclear weapons terrorist site as the site for our protest. We are, as a plowshare group, we are part of the actions that have started ever since 1980. Over 100 of them have happened. We had meetings before we did it in July the 28th of 2012, the United Nations Year of the Collective. Sister Megan was the one who named our action.
Wow. So Sister Megan, what got you started in protesting this particular avenue of anti-humanity?
My awareness of the evil that is involved in the intention to construct such a bomb goes back many decades. I happen to live close to the origin of the Manhattan Project, secret as it was, and at the age of 10 and 11, I knew that secret work was going on in the physics building at Columbia University, which was the beginnings of the Manhattan Project. And I knew that anything that is secret must be evil, because it has to be hidden from the public. And but I didn't really understand, even after the bombs were dropped on August 6th and August 9th, the terrible repercussions of this construction, which ended in 1945. I mean, at least those three bombs were constructed. But gradually, I continued to be aware of the actual makeup of nuclear weapons, and to hear the stories from my own uncle, who was present at Nagasaki 6 weeks after the bomb, of what he was able to see and what he was able to do during those months, observing and trying to help the people. But he was a Marine, and there were no people to help, actually, at that time. And so we realized the utter unthinkable that had occurred on those 2 days, August 6th and August 9th. And from then on, we were always trying to attend any efforts. Those who were acting as plowshares activists, we attended their trials, and we heard the explanations of why they had to, in conscience, act to resist and expose. And so I knew that I also, in whatever way I could, I spent 10 years at Nevada test site where we tried to help people to be aware that we had out on the beautiful sacred desert of Nevada, the size of the state of Rhode Island, where 1,000 of these nuclear bombs had been tested over the years from 1948 right through to 1993 at great cost to the land, the air, the water, the indigenous people whose land it was, and the downwinders who farmed for 50, 100 miles in diameter away from the Nevada test site. So I had plenty of information about it, and therefore I was responsible to act.
Wow. Now, it's one thing seeing the devastation that a nuclear bomb causes, but the weapons they're making today from depleted uranium-238, they're putting it in tank shells, in mortar shells, in weapon shells, in bullets. They're putting these nuclear waste into the small arms. How bad is that? I mean, that's even worse because you don't even see the effects that that's having, long-term residual effects that it has on the populations of the people of these places.
Yes, I believe you're referring to depleted, as they call it, depleted uranium, and it's highly resistant to penetration. And but it does cause it aerosolizes the tiny particles of as you say, this these uranium isotopes into the atmosphere, and people will be breathing it in for decades, and it will be, and it is already, we know from the wars in Iraq and other places in the Middle East, the aftermath of the use of depleted uranium, not only on weapons, but also on tanks, because it is so impenetrable when it's an alloy that's used to cover the tanks. Or other vehicles of war, and as you say, to coat the weapons themselves. Yes, depleted uranium is another form of mass extinction, really.
It's another form of nuclear weapon, yeah.
That's right.
Now, my question for both of you is, the nuclear industry is one that I see, myself personally, as being very anti-life and pro-profit. Do you think these big companies like Raytheon and Boeing and Northrop Grumman, these weapons industries, do you think they care that they're a threat to the actual global human health? Do you think they care enough because they're making so much money?
Yeah, I would say that they're not at all concerned about peace. They're not concerned about accepting Jesus Christ's peace offer when he said, my peace I give you, not as the world gives it. They're not concerned about the common good, or they're not concerned about the rule of international law. The Alliant Tech Systems company had its corporate headquarters at Edina, Minnesota. They produced the depleted uranium munitions and also the cluster bombs, both of which are illegal. And I believe the Persian Gulf syndrome, by the way, of the first Bush war in Iraq resulted from the unlawful use of depleted uranium munitions by the war criminal activity of the U.S. government in that particular war.
And we know that from the very beginning, even the leader of the first of the Manhattan Project, when after the testing of that first bomb, the Trinity bomb at Alamogordo in New Mexico, and he knew that the bombs worked, he also knew and believed firmly that one should never be used, let alone used on people. And when asked after the atrocities of Nagasaki and Hiroshima, about which he had been lied by leaders of the administration at the time, people who were in charge of the actual deployment of the three that were first produced. Mm. They were told that they would only be dropped on the Pacific and they knew that they were going to be dropped on land. Not exactly where, but it turned out to be on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. And he said from then on, he knew that this was just a gold rush, and it became the beginning of a gold rush. And there was an incredible amount of lying, as there had been from the very beginning of the project. People were lied to as they were held, as information was kept in secret as well.
Well, that's one thing that the government does very well, is lie to its people about what it's doing and the reasons why it does it. Now, I don't think they fully realized what they were doing when they decided to drop the bomb on Nagasaki and Hiroshima. The action that they gave, the order that they gave to eliminate human lives at that cost, at that price, or so many lives instantly all at once, that shows that there is an anti-human streak within these people. Do you not agree?
Well, I think that it's hard to make a judgment because of this incredible secrecy. Very few of the people were responsible for making the decision, and those that were made responsible for carrying it out did not know fully. So I would tend not to be judging those that were actually implementing at the beginning stage, implementing the orders, but certainly the individuals who were making the orders were extremely responsible and therefore guilty. But the same secrecy happens today. I think many of the workers at Y-12 Oak Ridge facility don't really know what they're doing from day to day. And also, there are very few jobs, and some people have to do that kind of work in order to have enough money to pay for their children's breakfast in this day and age. So it's the system that is evil and causing people to have to be doing such kind of work in order to, as we say, survive.
Absolutely, because if they don't do this work, there's always going to be somebody else who take that job who will do that work. Some people don't care who they work for.
Until we can convince, and I think it is possible that we can convince our government and the public that other things can be done, that just as you have said, it's useless to continue making nuclear bombs, and most of the public don't know that this is being continued. We know that just from speaking to individuals. They don't even know that we still have nuclear weapons, and we have at least 7,000 of them. And of course, none of them hopefully will ever be used. So it's a whole transformation in thinking. It has to happen through education in universities, colleges, high schools, and grammar schools. And people will realize, I think, it very easily they would be recognizing that if we can make bombs, we can unmake them, and we can transform things into that which is life-enhancing and really needed. And the appropriations can be reappropriated to that which is, first of all, to dismantle the nuclear weapons, and then to do what we can do in order to create a transformed economic system.
Amen. Well, let's hope for that. When I grew up as a young child in the 70s and 80s, we grew up with the specter of nuclear threats all the time. The Cold War was in well swing. It was in big effect. But back then, we only knew about nukes as far as being hydrogen bombs and atom bombs and nitrogen bombs. Today, they're given very catchy names like bunker busters and mother of all bombs and daisy cutters. And they're given cool names that sound really cool. Do you think that's part of the image of nuclear weapons, that they're changing the very nature of how people perceive them?
Well, there is a whole section of the Department of Defense that does nothing but create propaganda. And with our technology today, the misinformation can be very effectively communicated to the public. So I think you're absolutely right, and we have to do all that we can to return to, first of all, a press that's independent of being persuaded by the military-industrial complex to miseducate the public, which we know has been happening. So you're absolutely right, and we all need to, our awareness has to grow, and this critical thinking that is so necessary when we look at what is happening and why it is happening, and try to find those who are the objective investigative journalists who are giving us the truth in the alternative press.
Do you really believe that there's still independent investigative journalists out there? I do believe that a lot of the journalists we have had in the past, today, they're nothing but repeaters. They're not reporters anymore. They don't report on anything. They just repeat what they're told on the news. Do you still think that there's independent reporters out there?
Yes, I do. I know some of them.
So. Oh, wow. Okay.
Except that everybody is not alerted to it, but many people are. Yes, you have, and not only reporters, you have writers, you have professors who are spending their time writing the truth. You have Eric Schlosser as one. You have Elaine Scarry at Harvard producing her book, Nuclear Monarchy, shows how our democratic rights have been abrogated in just even the way we allow only one person in the country to decide when and where a nuclear weapon will be used.
Mm. Yeah, that's pretty scary. Now, for those who have just joined us here on the BBS Network, we're talking to Sister Megan Rice and Mr. Michael Walli, two anti-nuclear weapons activists who were imprisoned for 2 years for breaking into a nuclear weapons facility to alert the workers as to the work that they were doing against humanity. Please visit their website on transformplowshares.wordpress.com if you get a chance. Now, my question, Sister Megan, has the Catholic Church supported your protests in any way?
Yes. Well, I don't think we have heard too much, particularly as individuals, but we, our broad work is the work of condemning and trying to create alternatives to ever again the construction or production or planning to use nuclear weapons. And that certainly has been stated formally many times by the worldwide Catholic Church in its documents, and especially now Francis of Rome has condemned them when we had the excellent conference in Vienna in November-December of 2014, sent a special message to all the participants of that non-proliferation gathering in Vienna, condemning ever again the use of nuclear weapons.
I got a question for Mr. Michael Walli. How have your family handled you being so active and doing these protests against the nuclear industry? Have they supported you as well?
Well, I haven't been real close. It's not like we have a hotline going on between us, but they didn't poll them for their various opinions about the... they're not real closely involved, many of them, in supporting the condemnations given over the many years by the Roman Catholic Church of nuclear weapons, including the condemnation of nuclear weapons by this Catholic advocacy journalist woman named Dorothy Day, who condemned them 1 month after the Hiroshima and Nagasaki war criminal bombings. His Holiness Saint John the 23rd, as Pope, condemned nuclear weapons. He died on June the 3rd of 63. And various enlightened people, Dr. Martin Luther King, he condemned nuclear weapons at the age of 30 in 1959. all sorts of enlightened people have known that these are an evil to be opposed at every instant and to be eradicated. For over 2,700 years, prophets of God, Micah and Isaiah, have been forecasting the day when we shall have total global demilitarization. It's in the cards. It's going to happen. We have a surety and hope of these things, and we must be firm in our hope and hard at work as peacemakers.
Now, why is it that people just don't get it, that nuclear weapons are bad? Did Chernobyl not send a message to us that of the destructive awesomeness and how long, in fact, the half-life of this thing takes thousands and thousands of years for this stuff to deplete in the environment? Do people just not get it, how poisonous this stuff is? Go ahead.
Well, the Koreans have a saying, whose bread you eat, their song you'll sing. Many of the employees of the that are hard at work at the criminal activity of the U.S. government, nuclear weapons modernization and nuclear weapons proliferation in violation of the 1968 Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, they make a great deal of money, and as do the guard companies that guard these various places around the world. You cannot serve both God and money. They do what they do in secrecy. The New Testament counsels against secrecy. Judas worked as a spy. He took money from the corrupt priests. He betrayed the principes into the hands of the military government for money. And there's a big, I think there's a lot of clarity that is going on, and there's an increased awareness that's very encouraging about the nature of the will of God in human affairs concerning all of this warmongering and war-based economy and illegal weapons and contempt for the United Nations and the rule of international law.
Well, we can only hope that one day people will start to see that this is actually happening to us as a people, collectively, and realize that the borders are just invisible lines in the sand that they have drawn for us to divide us up between our different nations of people, when really we are all the same species. We are all the same race of people. We are the human race. Do you not agree with that?
Amen, brother. In India, they've got a Hindu bomb. In Israel, they've got a Judaic bomb. In Pakistan, they've got an Islamic bomb. In North Korea, they've got a communist bomb. In China, they've got a mixed capitalist-communist bomb. In France and the United States, the UK, various other countries, they've got a religious pluralism bomb. There's a lot of misuse of the name of religion to support the warmongering and the bomb. We've got to stop worshiping the bomb and send the bomb back to hell where it came from.
Absolutely. What do you feel about that, Sister Megan Rice?
Well, I think we need to also remember that we don't hear all the good news. How many of us are aware that after the non-proliferation event in last April of 2015, April and May, when the review meeting lasted 1 month at the United Nations, and they could not come to an agreement still on the final wording of that document, which has been signed since 1970, and so 108 countries out of the close to 190 United Nations countries walked out on the meeting determined that they would take a new stand, a humanitarian pledge, recognizing the reality that nuclear weapons must be eliminated and just work not for the non-proliferation but for the elimination of nuclear weapons because they threaten all of life on this planet.
Absolutely.
And I don't know how many people know that, but we need to back it, we need to follow it up, and we need to keep asking our Congress people, when are we going to come around and implement the treaties that have been signed? So it's really up to everybody who's listening tonight to look into this. We still don't have a condemnation of nuclear weapons as weapons of mass destruction in writing, but 103 nations are working toward that goal.
Well, archiving the crimes that have been done by the senators and the representatives in the last decade in America, I'm looking forward to the day when all of these liars and deceivers are going to get thrown in jail. But this is the People Speak Radio Show. I'm your host on BBS Radio, talking with special guests tonight, Sister Megan Rice and Mr. Michael Walli, live on Internet Radio. And we'll be right back with our guests and audience questions after this short message break.
If you care about humanity, if you care about stability for the human race, then you would care enough to stop funding Israel. Subscribe now.
You're listening to the People Speak Radio Show, coming to you live across America and across the world. I'm your host from Australia, Steve Johnson, and we're back with our two guests tonight. We have an amazing soul, two amazing souls, Sister Megan Rice and Mr. Michael Walli, both anti-nuclear protesters who have basically done the hard call. They've basically done the walk. They've walked the walk, they talk the talk, and they've gone to prison for it. Can you tell us a bit more about your arrest in Tennessee, Mr. Michael Walli and Sister Megan Rice? What exactly happened when you were arrested?
Go for it, Sister.
Okay. We spent from quarter to five in the morning until close to 5 o'clock doing the action that we had planned to do after we had passed through the three perimeter fences quite easily in a matter of probably less than 15 minutes. And we had done the work that many of you will know, you may have read about it, of us putting messages of truth, spray paint on the wall, and pouring sacred human blood on the building to remind people of the terrible results, extermination of human, of all life, which is so sacred by the use of any nuclear weapon anywhere. And also labeling the building as a crime scene with crime scene tape and other activities. Just probably 10 or 15 minutes, we saw a van moving in slowly from the far end of this huge, highly enriched uranium facility coming toward us, and we knew that that was probably a security officer. So we were ready to welcome him, and we had a statement to read to him, and he was able to listen. When he arrived there, he said to on the cell phone, "They are peace protesters. You better send some more security," or something like that. And so we asked him if we could read our message, and we read the message, which states our reason for having been there as people of faith, inspired by others, trying to live out that prophecy of beating swords into plowshares so that God would teach us God's ways and that there would be war no more. And so he listened carefully, and we told him the reason why we had used the blood and the candles and the white rose of forgiveness and the crime scene tape, and left an indictment which points out the laws which the United States has broken by the work that's conducted at that facility. And then by that time, we had, after reading it and offering him bread, which he didn't accept from us, the next van came, and then two officers were in that, and they came out and they handcuffed us. And that was like about quarter after five in the morning. And then we were made to lie down and wait around on our backs. And then for about 5 or 6 hours while they decided what they would do with us. And I suppose they had messages from higher authority that we were to be taken to jail. So at about 11 o'clock that morning, we were the three of us were driven together in one car, sitting together in the back seat, to the a local county jail, where we were kept for hearings in the court the next week after that, about a week. And then eventually we were released because they couldn't come. They had to have a trial. So the trial wasn't until the following May. And then after the following, that was May of 2013, we were sent to Ocilla, Georgia, which is a detention center, and stayed there for the next 7 or 8 months, and then the remaining time in other detention facilities or two prisons, federal prisons.
Wow.
And for a total of about 25 months.
Now, what do you remember of your arrest there in Tennessee, Mr. Michael Walli? Can you relate to us your experiences?
Well, we planned the event very carefully, and we were concerned. Sister Megan was 82 years of age at the time, and we talked about different things that might happen. You know, we might be attacked by dogs. We might be shot in the lethal force zone. We might have armed guards accosting us. The subject even came up when we were on the long walk through the woods in the middle of the night, walking with flashes. When we were planning, we even discussed the possibility of what we would do if we ran into a squad of Al-Qaeda. That didn't happen. We got to the site. We had asked for God to use us as instruments of peace, and we what we did was in the spirit of as law-abiding citizens of the world. We're citizens of heaven. We're citizens of the international community. We did it with benignity. We have hatred for no one. We oppose nuclear weapons wheresoever they exist, and they ought to stop using governance authority to retain them, to stockpile them, to threaten with them, to falsely say that these nuclear weapons are protecting anybody's security, or even that they can be legitimately possessed in the name of defending anybody. They're threatening us all. We've got to get rid of them on a priority basis.
Absolutely.
We were taken into custody, and then after several hours in broad daylight, they took our names, and then they put us in a paddy wagon, a police car, you know. And then they took us to a suburban Blount County jail, and we were held there for Sister Megan and I. We agreed about 6 days later to reappear at later court appearances. And we had our freedom for over 9 months until the trial started in May of 2013. The Lamar Alexander Parkway is one of the three, I heard, worst prisons in the entire United States as a result of being a prisoner for over 2 years. I saw a great deal of the lack of humanity and the lack of U.S. government compliance with its legal obligations concerning the treatment of prisoners. I saw two men getting tasered, and then I wasn't at all surprised, right in front of the Blount County Jail, where we were imprisoned in suburban Knoxville. The street that goes right by it is named the Lamar Alexander Parkway. Well, Senator Lamar Alexander is one of the two U.S. senators representing the state of Tennessee. He's been very vigorously, enthusiastically supporting this Antichrist nuclear weapons industry that is one of the driving engines of the eastern Tennessee area, and it employs thousands of people. And he should be ashamed of himself, and he should work instead to do a good born again and work to get rid of these weapons.
Well, anybody who supports nuclear weapons, in my book, is a very, very dangerous person. Now, right here on the line, we've got a caller in from Ohio. We've got Dave on the line. Are you there, Dave?
Yeah, I'm actually calling from North Carolina. I really appreciate this.
Sure, go ahead.
I actually have two questions. First, I want to say I very much admire your wonderful efforts. I admire all the Plowshares actions. When I lived in Baltimore, I used to worship at Jonah House. I particularly admire the fact that you did something very unusual and that you pleaded guilty. I'm an advocate of people who do civil disobedience at least considering pleading guilty, as Gandhi always did. I know it's not for everybody. Why is it you folks decided to plead guilty?
Excuse me, we did not plead guilty. We pleaded not guilty to all four of the charges, and we continued to plead not guilty when the trial started with the two remaining felony charges, of which we were found guilty on May the 8th of 2013. So the answer is that we continually, from start to finish, right up until the present moment, we pleaded not guilty of all charges.
Well, all we did, we accepted the fact that we had done what we had done because we were exposing and opposing the existence of nuclear weapons at that facility. The actions that we performed were positive, life-enhancing actions. They were not destructive of the building. Yeah.
We believe that we were acting lawfully in compliance with our Nuremberg principles, obligation as citizens to oppose the crimes of the United States government. That's what we did, and we continue to oppose these ongoing crimes.
Well, that is what's popular among people who do civil disobedience in this country. My second question is a difficult question, but I have to guarantee you that I'll be loving and forgiving, even if I'm not happy with your answer. You stated earlier that you believe that there are many alternative media personalities who are not just repeaters. I am also a 9/11 truth activist, and so many pacifists won't even discuss the evidence that the official story is a lie. Do you believe that Amy Goodman is one of these alternative media commentators who is not just a repeater?
Absolutely.
I was very impressed by Amy Goodman. 3 days after our May the 16th release, Sister Megan and our co-defendant, we participated in her Democracy Now! Program. She's a very enlightened, countercultural, visionary person who is trying to swim against the current and get the truths about what's going on before the public. She has opposed all sorts of criminal activities conducted by the U.S. government. She's tried to get to the truth and to spread the truth around. I'm much impressed by her. But for me as an individual, I am not a technician. I'm not highly educated. I personally plead ignorance about how those buildings went down exactly. Personally, I don't know, but I defer to the scientists to explain it all.
Right. Thanks very
I'd
much.
I'd like to correspond with you folks. I'll go to your website to correspond with you.
Thank you so much. It was nice.
Thanks very much, sir, Dave. Good questions. My question to Sister Megan and Mr. Walli, why did Obama, the president, get a Nobel Peace Prize? Do you think he's actually done anything for peace at all? And why would they give a peace prize to a guy like that when he's ordered more drone strikes than anybody?
Go ahead, Sister.
I would not feel competent to make a judgment on this. We have no knowledge of who is really behind the scenes in our administration, unfortunately. He certainly began in his campaign to make promises, and many of those promises he's certainly not been able to fulfill. But I think our problem is that we don't have independent politicians, people who are able to act according to their consciences. And so I would certainly not be one to make a judgment on someone in a position like that.
Do not get me wrong. Right. I'm not asking you to judge Obama. I'm not asking you to put a judgment call on him. My point is, I have seen chimpanzees in New York Zoo do more for world peace than Obama ever has.
It's a mystery. Some of the things that that he has said and done seem to be inconsistent with one another. I'm sure he said that he personally doesn't like nuclear weapons, but on the other hand, he has been part of the problem of supporting the modernization efforts in the congressional budgetary outlays to perpetuate the U.S. Nuclear weaponry policies into perpetuity, at least until calendar year 2080, which is, mind you, 112 years after the 1968 Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, which was signed by the U.S., the U.S. is legally obligated to comply with that, the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, whose provisions took effect in 1970, but there's no compliance signs afoot right now. He said that he's against torture, but then he went to Central Intelligence Agency headquarters in Langley, Virginia, and he gave the employees there a preemptive pardon for the criminal activities, including torture, that had been orchestrated by the policies of his predecessor. I do not understand the man, and I don't judge the man, but on the other hand, the Word of God tells us that by their works shall ye know them. Much of what the U.S. government is done in secrecy. They talk about mistransparency, but she is very, very rarely ever cited.
Absolutely. Very, very good answer there, Mr. Michael Walli. Now, question to you, Sister Megan. From what I see today, that the power of the Pharisees has not waned from the ancient days. They still have the power. The power of the Pharisees, and indeed the big corporations, seems to match what they had in the ancient days. Do you think today, on planet Earth, we are living in one big slave plantation that has evolved? Do you believe that?
It's not a matter of believing. You've used a very good simile or a model for what is actually happening. I certainly agree with you that people are subjected to, as we say, the most important part of it is the miseducation and the misreporting in the press, and therefore subjected to lies, and a culture of fear has pervaded. So that is a form of slavery, absolutely.
Now, how do you think that Jesus would feel about nuclear weapons? Do you think he would support them or oppose them? I mean,
we all know it's not a matter of even giving an opinion on that. I think we all, or making a speculation, we know that the message is, I have come that they may have life and have it more abundantly. And the whole purpose and work to construct a bomb that can destroy the planet now 400 times the power of the first three nuclear weapons, at least the first one that was dropped on Hiroshima. It's truly diabolical, and we must do all that we can to expose and oppose any further construction and work for the deconstruction and the transformation of that military nuclear industrial complex, which is purely a money-making operation for the few who have the contracts. And not even the workers are getting the profits. They do get jobs, but the huge amount of profit that go to the CEOs of these corporations.
Since you both...
Nuclear weaponry policies of the U.S. government has nothing to do with the rule of law, with the desires of those people who founded the United Nations in 1945 to bring about, usher in world peace. It has nothing to do with the common good. It has a lot to do with money-making, selfishness, and greed, and nationalism, and the ongoing efforts often of the U.S. government to pickle the minds of the public through these secretive, spin control news releases.
Absolutely. Do you both think that America today is the Great Babylon, as described in Revelations?
I mean, those were very apt descriptions of the political activities that were going on under the Roman Empire, wherever there was someone trying to control the lives of others. And we certainly have that happening in our world today. We have individuals in governments, and we have institutions in governments which are functioning in that manner. It's a very good and apt model or parable for what is happening today. Mm. Yes.
Any thoughts there, Mr. Walli?
Well, you know, earlier this year in May, when we had one of our two felony charges overturned, the one that said that we were guilty of sabotage, so we have only one remaining charge, and they falsely say that we were destroying government property, such as by cutting through those criminal fences that are part of the criminal activities at Oak Ridge Y-12 U.S. government terrorists. Earlier this year in May, there was the 141st running of the Kentucky Derby, and a horse named American Pharoah won. And it seems to me like whoever which one of the U.S. presidential kingpin wannabes gets elected, they'll operate outside of the rule of law. They'll have contempt for Dr. Martin Luther King's legacy of nonviolence and his opposition to the nuclear weapons. They'll have no respect for the common good. And they'll continue to try publicly and secretly to continue this illegal, ungodly, unpatriotic effort to dictate human affairs outside of the rule of law. They'll be like an American Pharaoh of the whole wide world.
Wow.
And they've a stranglehold, disproportionate stranglehold on the wealth of the world, and the military weapons, and the war-based economy, and they want more.
Amazing. Listen, thank you very much for being guests today on the People Speak Radio Show. I certainly would love to have you back again. We've got some more questions, but just no time for it. Thank you so much for appearing today on the show.
Thank you
for all your questions and your comments.
It's been fantastic having you, and certainly I'd like to ask you some more about what it was like in prison, whether you got treated okay and whether the people were supporting you and how much support you've seen since then. But we'll have to leave that for another show. Join us upcoming soon on the People Speak Radio Show when I talk with political artist and author Kate Howarth and esteemed researcher Morgan Reynolds. Stay tuned for those interviews coming soon. Big thanks go out to the producers, Mike and Donald, to all my friends throughout the world, and all the guys who give me such support. Thank you from the bottom of my heart. You can tune into my own channel called Stop Funding Israel, but for now, for me, take care and bye until next time.
One bright sunny morning in the shadow of the sea.